the Around the NFL podcast.
Has got that dog in there.
Oh, yeah.
From the Chris Wessling podcast studio, it's Around the NFL. I am Dan Hanzus, heroes here, Gregg Rosenthal, Marc Sessler, and I think, hope everybody had a nice weekend. Gregg, Marc is a Hollywood legend. He's a cinephile. You thought he wouldn't see seconds before we started. You're like, I heard the new Mission Impossible wasn't that great. Marc was like, I beg to differ, because he sees them all.
Well, you said that you heard it was the worst one. I would disagree with that, only because I can think of a few that I very much disliked. This one was...
That it was all like about teamwork and being... It was kind of corny compared to the last one.
I think it pointed fun at itself, like in a way that was...
A little winking, a little self-referential, yeah. We were also talking about, we both saw Oppenheimer.
Right.
It's fine.
I agree. Like, did it blow me off the earth? I liked it. I saw it at 6 a.m., to be honest, which was, I've never done in a theater. I don't think.
Were you tired?
I thought, like, I got up super early and even went running to try to be like, and drank some coffee to be like, I'm going to go into this thing feeling like it's midday. And it was like, terrifying. It was around 6:53. And I'm like, I'm nodding off here. Like, I'm struggling to stay awake.
If the movie started at 6.
Yeah.
And you
was it full?
Went running.
Yeah, jam packed.
What time did you pull on your gym shoes and hit the pavement?
Like 4:30. Well, the theater's across the street from where I live, so I didn't have
did
to
Did you get sleep?
What do you mean?
Did you go to sleep before the run?
I tried to go. Previously, I went to sleep at like 10-something at night. I tried to.
Best
I could.
Well, that's good.
Yeah. Well, no, it was an attempt to not try to go straight from bed to a theater and then just continue to sleep in a dark, cozy theater.
Smart.
So it was a battle. You saw it at 9. Easier.
Yeah.
I'd assume.
Yeah. It was fine. Other pop culture news, and we got so much to get to in the NFL, of course. It is around the NFL. But today, in fact, it's going to happen during today's taping. They have a raffle amongst NFL media employees to see Taylor Swift, the Eras Tour, next Tuesday right here at SoFi Stadium. And it is all anyone is talking about right now. I mean, this whole building is on fire with like 26-year-olds that can't stop talking about will they get the tickets, which are going for thousands of dollars on the secondary market. Let's bring in Sean Kelly behind the glass here. Shawnee, give us the temperature of the Generation Z right now.
Well, it's really hot, Dan. It's everybody is firing on all ballistics today. I'm just all the middle, like the mid-20s is just buzzing. The office group chats on Slack are just going bonkers. Everybody wants these Tay-Tay tickets.
Don't do that.
That was offensive.
I'm in the, isn't that her nickname?
I'm just the way, coming through your, the way that you did it.
Oh, it's okay. Also two tickets. There's got to be hundreds of people in this raffle.
Yeah, there's a lot of people in the raffle.
Aren't they? It's Swifties, right? Like,
Swifties? Yeah. I always thought that was their nickname. I don't know. I have good luck in raffles. I'm not generally going for the tickets. I've already promised a coworker that the tickets would be theirs if I do win.
And I see Christy Stapleton behind you.
It is Christy Stapleton behind me, yes. She will be getting the tickets, but it's going to be an intense event. I'm assuming 12 p.m. for the drop. They just said Monday, so that's like a good middle-of-the-day line.
Can you be our official monitor of this?
Yes.
If it happens during the show, come in with some breaking news.
So there will be a breaking news.
Yeah. Sean Kelly came in here and told us he was doing this whole thing, and Gregg informed him logically, like, you're probably not going to win. And Sean acknowledged, this was his quote, the odds are heavily stacked against me. So at least he's got a dose of reality.
Who doesn't love it?
But he's good at raffles, apparently.
He's the Brock Purdy of this. You know, everyone's counting him out.
If they can fill up the parking lot, the lines, whether she can match BTS.
I would not doubt
she's going to crush
Taylor Swift
BTS
right now.
I'd resell them. I'd win it, then resell them.
Ooh.
I don't think that's allowed.
You're not allowed to do that.
Yeah,
that
officially, I would.
Are you in the raffle?
I don't have email right
now.
I'm in. This computer situation.
I'm in. And it actually, the show conflicts with the Hard Knocks premiere next week and the podcast I'll be doing with Colleen. So maybe my tickets would go up for grabs.
What a wild time.
Colleen, Christy, you're out though because you kind of hinted you might poison me to get the tickets that I already have that I'm going with my wife on Monday. So.
Oh, this was a long like brag.
Yeah.
Got it.
I'm already going. All right.
All right, good stuff.
All right, here we go. She did. She kind of hinted, hey, if you were to get sick, I'll take your tickets.
Is it too late to enter this raffle?
Bro. Yes. Yeah. You're out, bro.
Okay.
All right. The NFL is really starting to heat up now, boys. The pads are on.
That was a big thing.
Big thing.
Monday throughout the league, the pads are on. Now, for a few teams, they were on before that. four or five teams before that. But the pads are
on. But now everybody.
Football's back.
Now it's back, right?
Well,
pads are on.
Yeah, sure.
Until the there's a game this week.
Then it's back.
Then it's back.
And football.
But then then we realize the preseason is somewhat of a sham, and so then it's going to be back at a later date.
Well, actually, right. But also you put the pads on, but the way the rules are now, you can't do full tackling, full hitting for another few days. So that
then it's back.
Then it's back,
sort of.
And then when the preseason actually kicks off in earnest, to me, that's when football's back.
It's vaguely back at that point.
Until Thursday, the week one opener, football's back.
Bingo.
But really, it's the Sunday that follows.
Well, it really doesn't even count until Thanksgiving.
That's when the season starts.
Right.
Football's back. And really, it really comes down to one game in the end, the Super Bowl.
And it's really,
that's
and it's
when
here.
Football's
that's
truly
it's
back.
It's dark.
All right, we're going to share some whispers coming out of training camps across America.
Whispers.
Creepy. But first, some news.
I kind of live by saying, if you ain't got no haters, you ain't popping. So hate away.
We're going to get to the storyline around Sean Payton. One of the better kind of summer stories that has ever happened on this podcast as we enter year 11. I don't think there's so many layers to it. It's wonderful. It's wonderful.
Well, we're so used to players going at each other, you know, online or in some form. It's coaches. When it's coaches, it stands out, and I find it delicious.
And not for nothing. Sean Payton, your initial when, you know, I have to do some damage control – I thought I had my Fox hat on. You never said anything interesting on Fox.
That you cannot use that as an excuse.
Someone point out one thing Sean Payton said in his year on Fox that anyone ever talked about.
Endless milquetoast commentary.
The only thing I remember
trying to get a new job
is like him wearing those like pandas, you know, the dunks, like the sneakers that he wore every. That was about all that anyone took away.
And the goodbye tweet from Fox, which is like, Sean Payton, thank you for everything you've done. It's like, what, take $8 million of our dollars? All right, let's get to it, starting with obviously the big news that broke. And yes, we are undefeated here. This is what we do. We record podcasts, and then major news happens immediately following the recording of said podcast. It happened on Thursday at Bengals practice, where Joe Burrow rolled out to his right, pulled up with a calf issue, was later diagnosed as a sprain. An injury that's expected to keep him out several weeks. So you're not going to see him in the preseason. Obviously, NFL Network's Mike Garofolo reports that week one, quote, should be realistic for Burrow. However, Greggy, a couple things here. Number one, this, I believe, is the fourth straight year. Burrow's summer has been impacted either by the recovery of an injury or COVID or an occurrence of an injury.
Appendectomy last year.
Right. It's not an ideal situation, obviously, for Cincinnati. Not one that they can't overcome. Of course, he had the appendectomy last year and had his best year ever. Still not great. The other concern here, Greg, is the calf is one of those injuries where it could come back. And if you come back too soon and injure it again, all of a sudden, everything's up in the air.
Right. I think of Kevin Durant, obviously a very different sport. But doing that and then tearing his Achilles coming
right
soon off the calf strain. And it can linger. It can come back and forth. It's disappointing. He was really excited, Joe Burrow, to have a camp. And you can point out, yeah, like he ended up having a great year last year, but he's tended and the Bengals have tended to start the year slowly. You remember that disastrous week one game he had against the Steelers. They also lost week two to the Cowboys,
right.
And he was trying to avoid that. The thing, if you're a Bengals fan, I think you are holding on to here is they're not making any move to bring in another quarterback. Trevor Siemian is probably their backup. It might be Jake Browning. They did sign a quarterback, I think a USFL guy, Reed Sennett. But if they were really worried he was going to be out into the regular season, don't you got to give old Teddy a call or Carson Wentz? Like, we have some real players that can play quarterback here. The season's over if you're playing Jake Browning in a bunch of meaningful games. So I got to think they are pretty confident he's back for week one.
That has to be the biggest bomb for Bengals fans, that exact thing, that they're not, there's no panic. I thought even their social media account was being playful with the whole thing in the hours and days after. But, you know, there was this moment, because our Thursday show was about rivalries, and that we dug into the past, but one we talked about was this like triumvirate of the Chiefs, the Bills, and the Bengals. And we're driving home as this news is breaking, and it's one of the few times that Twitter slash X is, to me, really valuable, because you're just refreshing over and over, trying to find out what news is. But the news got softer and softer and softer about the injury itself. But there was a moment there where I'm just imagining, like, wait a minute, the AFC suddenly, the Bengals are a non-factor, essentially, if Joe Burrow is gone. And it changes the way you think about the season. It's just a reminder that, like, you can talk about these teams month after month in the offseason, but then now it's like, we are going to start to, we're going to lose about 20% of the people that we spend our time talking about this season. And it's like the complexion of the AFC would have changed drastically. But I don't like calf injury, because you're right. If you tweak that thing, it's like, can come back and knock you out for a month more, month or more.
Football is a completely different sport than baseball. But
yeah, in multiple ways.
I would say that you still have to look at it as a long year, right? And I would just hope there's always this thing, all players are and all teams are, they always circle week one for injuries. They're like, oh, he'll be okay for week one. But if there's any concern that he's not 110% ready, yes, I would say, you know, if you have to go a couple of weeks out Burrow to ensure that he doesn't pop his Achilles in October, do it. We'll see. Man, that would stink.
Start with a couple division games, Browns and Ravens. It does get me thinking, like, I looked at this, and there's some other quarterback situations around the league. Like, this CBA really does job veteran players, guys like a Teddy Bridgewater or Carson Wentz. It's crazy that, like, Jordan Love's backup right now is a fifth-round rookie no one liked, like Sean Clifford. Like, Matthew Stafford's backup is Stetson Bennett. They got no real backup in Cincinnati. Like, a lot of teams out there just go so cheap on these rookie deals, where, like, in other sports, guys like Teddy Bridgewater and Carson Wentz, I'm not a huge Wentz fan, but it's like they can play. But the way the CBA is structured, it's like these mid-level veterans just get totally left out in the cold.
In some cases, though, they're looking for the right landing spot and job too, and role, because it's like Teddy Bridgewater's made a ton of money. He doesn't have to.
That's what I mean, though. But in other sports, like high-level backups get like $10 million a year. That's a quarterback position. They're not going to be getting more than
$3
million.
CBA
anyways.
And the rookie wage scale in part put in as a benefit to the veterans, though, because rookie contracts are so crazy.
Yes, but it ended up helping the stars and crushing the middle class.
Right.
That's why since then, those contracts, those rookie contracts, are so valuable that there's a way higher percentage of rookies in the league, a way lower average age, the average career length is shorter. Like, it's really helped out there. I don't know. It's just a random thought. I'm just thinking, like,
they signed another CBA after that. So
the 2011 one.
But have they signed another one since? They have, right?
There was a new one created, yeah.
So the players didn't get that tossed out. But you're right. That does seem to be, in general, and you're seeing it with all the running back stuff, the players maybe didn't get the deal they wanted in retrospect. When Robert Kraft was hugging.
Yeah, I think we're learning that now.
Yes. All right. The NFL Network's Ian Rappaport reports that Jalen Ramsey underwent a full meniscus repair surgery. It's going to take him out of the picture until December. So the Dolphins, obviously, when they acquired Ramsey, Mark, they saw him as a linchpin of that defense, a guy who's a future Hall of Famer potentially, that they believed had elite years, and maybe he'll come back in December and be elite and be a nice, jump start. But this is really bad news. It's a significant injury that requires a significant amount of missed time.
It's a really stacked defense. When we were looking at it, you know, a couple months ago, it's like it's hard to find a weakness. Injuries will create that. They went out and signed Eli Apple. Not the worst signing there. I think they need some depth, but they've still got Xavier Howard. Cam Smith is a second-year guy, or actually a rookie. So, I don't know. I mean, I think you've got Vic Fangio. I trust him to kind of maximize everyone. I kind of love the pairing of Mike McDaniel and Vic Fangio. But when you start losing guys like Ramsey, the only, I guess, the bright spot would be is if he comes back and he's healthy in December, that might be perfect timing for like a push.
Mike McDaniel on the Jalen Ramsey surgery.
I think the surgery went about as well as it could have. So we're elated about that. And, you know, in terms of where his mindset is at, he's a self-proclaimed alien, and you know he couldn't have a better mindset with which to attack this process. He's immediately tell me whatever the timeline is, and I'm going to beat it by a month.
Mm. I thought it was interesting how his contract really maybe led to the path they took surgery-wise. Our guy Rapshi pointed out he got fully guaranteed salaries in 23 and 24. I was critical of that trade because they were acting like Ramsey got a lot out of it, and he really didn't. He didn't get a raise. He's kind of under a pretty, I think, team-friendly contract, but this was the positive, was that he got his salaries guaranteed. And it wasn't hard to read between the lines that the team, or in a different scenario, might have preferred a smaller surgery, that he would have been returning in September, like mid-September, that it would have been not a full repair of the meniscus. That was the initial reports. And then they said, well, they're going to see how it looks like. And Rapshi all but said, look, if he was a free agent next year, he might be coming back on less of a complete surgery. And so it's interesting. You talked about Mariota last week. It's kind of a similar situation here, except Ramsey's protected by a guaranteed salary in 2024, so he doesn't need to rush it. He wants to get all the way better. And I'm not that worried about the Dolphins. I think their secondary could be very good. I like Kader Kohu as the slot. I like Brandon Jones, Javon Holland as the safety, Xavier Howard, Cam Smith. Some people love him as a rookie. Like, they're pretty deep at cornerback.
Okay, in other news, you have Jonathan Taylor, running back of the Colts, who has been outspoken about all the running back drama and the pay, and he wants a new contract. And we talked about it last week that Jim Irsay, the owner of the Colts, has been outspoken about, you know, the CBA and how it was structured and how owner or agents were not operating in good faith with this situation. This led to what was said to be by beat reporters a dramatic moment where there's some type of luxury mobile, like, home or something.
I think he's bought like a Jerry Jones.
He's got a lower level Jerry
he's
Jones.
He's got a new
bus.
He's got the Irsay bus now.
So there's an Irsay bus adjacent to the practice field, and Taylor and Irsay late last week meeting it for an hour. They come out of that meeting, didn't go so hot, I guess, because Taylor, we learn, has asked for a trade. This then rolls into the next part of this storyline. That Taylor reported back pain during his pre-training camp physical that was deemed to be an injury that was not sustained while playing for the Colts. The situation now has the team considering whether to place Taylor on the non-football injury list, which could result in Indy withholding his salary. Yikes, that's according to Stephen Holder at ESPN. And then Jonathan Taylor hits back on Twitter, or X, and says, one, never had back pain. Two, never reported back pain. Not sure who sources are, but find new ones. And then just for fun, here is...
Find new ones.
Here is Irsay talking about an increasingly big mess involving his best offensive player.
If I die tonight and Jonathan Taylor's out of the league, no one's going to miss us. The league goes on. I mean, you know, we know that. The national football rolls on. It doesn't matter.
Look, sunglasses.
Know, who comes and who goes.
Jackie L.
Yeah, you know, and it's a privilege to be part of it. And now is the time, you know, for us to do our work. It's now is the time as an organization and, you know, players that are, you know, 24, 25 years old. Now is the time to seize the moment of greatness.
Mm. He hit him with the Kyle Shanahan. We might not even be here on Sunday. I mean, I would miss you, Jim. I mean, don't, you know. I think
he's talking about the big picture.
Yes, he's technically correct.
And the league, I mean, sure.
Be careful about
the league would move on. I'm sure Jonathan Taylor loved hearing this. The funny thing was the timeline of this.
Get back out there, kid.
So that interview happened after they got off the bus. And that interview, Irsay said, we're going to keep it in-house, what me and Jonathan talked about. It's going in a good direction. A great Twitter moment, because 15 minutes later, Rapshi then reports Taylor wants a trade. And then Irsay has to respond. Like, and then Irsay responded after that. He's not going anywhere. Like, he's going to be on this team. There's no way we're trading him.
Wait, so his we're all going to die thing came
before
the trade demand.
Well, I think after the actual trade demand, but he tried to hide it from the public. He's like, we're not going to talk about that publicly. We're not going to say what happened between us. 10 minutes later, it comes out, Jonathan Taylor requests.
I love the Irsay quote. I couldn't agree more. I mean, we would just keep rolling on no matter what happens in this situation. We're talking about it today. It'll be old news soon enough. They'll figure it out. I think if you're like – It's just another extension. I said on our last show that I the whole running back thing, I empathize with him vaguely, but like I'm starting to get tired of the whole situation. It is what it is. But like Jonathan Taylor, like you want to get traded, like you're going to need to find, if this even vaguely could happen, like you need to get a team that sort of says we're a Super Bowl window. You're not going to get someone to trade for Jonathan Taylor and offer a massive extension. It's like, you're a free agent after this year. Maybe we bring you in, we plug you in for 1 year and make a run of it. But that has to be a team that has an excellent offensive line. Because if you look at last year, what happened with the Colts, like Jonathan Taylor is an all-pro level running back, not behind a bad offensive line. That offensive line needs to be patched together and be a better unit overall to actually get anything out of the running back situation. They also have Zach Moss, who suffered a broken forearm today. They're in a bad spot at that position.
Yeah, they are. And I understand I have empathy for the running backs, but again, Taylor, I don't know, and I don't like the way Irsay put that, like, hey, now's the time for these kids to be out there playing, because that's too reductive, and you understand why these players understand. For the same reasons, Irsay saying get out there and play because the window is short, that's why these guys are trying to get paid right now, because they know there's not a big payday coming 5 years from now.
I think he's just mad at his boss. It might be a rare case where he would just rather play for another team, even if he wasn't getting the contract. Because to your point, Mark, I don't think there's a single team in the NFL that would be willing to give up a decent draft pick and a good contract.
Well, that's what
for
I was
going
to say, which is
he's coming off an injured year where he didn't look
season.
Great when he did play.
And we don't know this physical. Who knows what's going on with this physical? But if the ankle is a part of the red flag here, which it sounds like it, it's like, am I going to give a long term huge contract to a running back who was in someone else's building that suffered a serious injury to his ankle that's still not healed yet? I just think he's not being realistic. There's no contract coming for this guy.
But could you see
from
a team,
the Colts or anybody else?
Could you see a team? I don't know. Like, you could think of someone like the Cowboys or someone's like, oh, we'll do this for a third round pick. And then it's like, we've got, you know, like some team.
But then you got to pay him.
Right. But someone, you don't
but
have
maybe
to.
Not. Like, maybe they don't.
It's a 1 year thing. And then, like, yeah. I think to Jonathan Taylor's point, like, he just wants out of this world of disrespect in Indianapolis. You get a 1 year situation on a good team, then you go out to free agency. It might be a better situation for him than trying to lobby for a contract he's not going to get right now.
Chris Ballard has to have the least amount of power of just about any GM out there, because he was quoted saying how important Jonathan Taylor was to this team not that long ago, how he did want him long term. And I think he was being truthful. And then you see these reports about them trying to put him on the NFI list. And the reason they would do that is because they wouldn't have to pay him. And that, it seems like a threat. It seems like dirty pool. It seems like if you had to do some source guessing, it's probably coming from ownership, not from the front office, because I don't think the front office wants to make him any more mad. And so this could be a situation where the emotions are so hot that something does happen.
We had this conversation a week or two ago. Oh, what has us shook? I mentioned just like, what, you know, the Colts, like you have an owner that's increasingly expressing, you know, how he feels in public and has more control than ever, it seems, in terms of the football operations. That would have me shook as a Colts fan, because you want something collaborative, not just the owner pointing things out and saying, this is how everything has to be.
And you could say whatever you want about running backs. Jonathan Taylor is vital to this team. Our friend,
yeah,
Daniel Jeremiah pointed it out. He should, like, he's got a lot of these good thoughts. He could collect them together, do a podcast.
Say it into a microphone.
Right, yeah, like
it's
an audio
a, it's
show.
A growing, yeah, thing. So it's just not, you know.
Who cares about Jeremiah?
That's a good one. He pointed out there's no explosive element to this offense. Anthony Richardson is all sorts of explosive, but Michael Pittman, not the fastest guy in the world. Alec Pierce, that's not really his game. He's, you know, he's going to catch some jump balls. Josh Downs, that's not him. They don't have it at running back. Like, Jonathan Taylor is their explosive guy.
One last note, by the way, on the Colts camp. Anthony Richardson, aforementioned, got a nose job. All right, in other news.
He did not get
a
nose
what?
Job.
I mean, you could call it that.
Our guy, Rap Sheet, said specifically it was not a nose job. But, yes, it was something to do with, like,
septum, like, corrected or something internally. I don't think
a nose job.
It wasn't reshaped. I mean, sure, you could call it that.
It wasn't a cosmetic surgery.
I was thinking,
why wait till camp to get a nose job?
I was thinking how funny that term is. And it's just everyone's, oh, you get a nose job? Like, nose job. It's just kind of funny.
It is.
Two funny words put together.
Yes, it is.
Anthony Richardson got a nose job. That is not inaccurate. It's just
it is,
like not the
nose job.
It's not a cosmetic surgery.
Cosmetic surgery.
It implies, but I didn't say.
It is.
Anyway.
It is not accurate at all.
If you asked the surgeon, oh, Richardson, did he check out? Oh, yeah, earlier. Nose job? Yeah. No.
That's what you think a surgeon would
be like,
yeah,
I fixed the septum.
Casual surgeon.
No, I'd follow up. Oh, what type of nose job? Oh, septum correction.
Okay. Welcome back to Earth, Dan. Well, I don't know what you're living in a different universe than Greg and I.
Aaron Rodgers, Sean Payton, Nathaniel Hackett, Robert Saleh, bunch of players around the Jets. It's a big old stew of funkiness after Payton shot off to USA Today about how terrible Hackett and the Broncos coaching staff was last year. As I said, Payton then came out the next day when I don't know how another element of the story. How long has he been in this game? Did he not realize that this was going to be a major storm? Did he not see this coming? Or
I like
had
Greg's,
our other theories.
I like Greg's theory,
we had the other
that maybe
theory.
You know, when he gave the interview, you're in a bit of
a little more clear-headed
headed
state.
Yes.
Yeah.
He just was a little loose, despite all the like the all the Denver reporters and nationally where they were like, "Hey, if Sean Payton does it, he has intention behind it. He has purpose to everything he does." Cut to the next
carry
morning. Sean Payton's like, actually, I totally regret it. Why did I do that?
Yeah. So you heard Robert Saleh, obviously, in the news drop, how he addressed it a couple days ago.
You got no haters, you ain't popping.
My favorite part was Claybon's reaction to that in real time, just burying his face in his hands with cringe. But then Schrager was at Jets camp this weekend for Back Together
Weekend.
NFL Network. Great job by everyone on the team. And this
save
is
for us.
Well, we were supporters.
Okay.
Yeah.
I do support what they did.
We were in the stands clapping. Yay! Everybody did great. Here is Schrager teed up Rodgers in a way that gave Rodgers a chance to give a very kind of nondescript answer, but Rodgers was very descriptive in his response.
Yeah, I love Nathaniel Hackett, and those comments were very surprising. For a coach to do that to another coach, my love for Hack goes deep. You know, we had some great years together in Green Bay, kept in touch, love him and his family. He's an incredible family man, incredible dad. And on the field,
I could say that.
You know, he's arguably my favorite coach I've ever had in the NFL. Just his approach to it, how he makes it fun, how he cares about the guys, just how he goes about his business with respect, with leadership, with honesty, with integrity. And
pause it.
It made me feel bad that someone.
Now the blowtorch comes out.
Yeah.
All right, play it.
Who's accomplished a lot in the league is that insecure that they have to take another man down to set themselves up for some sort of easy fall if it doesn't go well for that team this year. Thought it was way out of line and inappropriate, and I think he needs to keep my coach's names out of his mouth.
That's my quarterback.
Also, if you're Peter Schrager, who looks good in those sunglasses right there, you know, oh, I've just generated an absolute heat seeker of an interview.
Nice
good.
Job for NFL Plus. That was on NFL
nice
Plus.
Nice job by Plus.
First, they get us locked in to doing some content this season, and then that. Big
on fire.
By the way, I love that. First of all, you know, I'm a Jets fan. I love that. I love Rodgers being all fired up there. I also like, or what? Like, what is Aaron Rodgers actually going to do if Sean Payton says something else? Is he going to punch him in the mouth in week five? Like, that was that a physical threat by Aaron Rodgers towards Sean Payton? I love it all. This story is ridiculous and beautiful.
I thought of this quote that I often think of. It was by an author I like, Rachel Cuss, where she wrote, like, I thought how often people betrayed themselves by what they notice in others. And to me, this was a game recognizes game. Who has purposefully managed the media in deceptive ways more over the last 10 years than Aaron Rodgers and Sean Payton? Like, these two guys are similar. And Rodgers, like, when he's saying that how you feel bad for a guy that he would be so insecure that he would bring down others in the process, you almost feel like it's like, oh, that's something Rodgers hit on in therapy a couple years ago when he was burying his his management. And so, like, I don't think he's wrong, and I think he's speaking from experience what Payton
maybe
was doing there. I loved it.
Maybe if you peel back the layer, maybe he was more just like – It's a way of saying he was disappointed that Payton, the guy who's playing the game as long as he had, isn't a little more cunning and was so surface level about it rather than Rodgers, who will do the back channel route to try to destroy his enemies.
I think part of it, too, is because, like, when people would absolutely verbally flame, like, Urban Meyer, it's like, Urban Meyer seems like an unlikable individual. And, like, Nathaniel Hackett, yes, that was a botched job. We all knew out of the gate. You know, you're a month into the season wondering how soon he might be fired. But Nathaniel Hackett has never been described as someone who is not, like, a warm, enjoyable guy. There's something about, like, I think the coach-on-coach hate is so rare. We don't see it that often. But I've always thought what Sean Payton was trying to do, and he did not do it elegantly at all, was reset Russell Wilson with the locker room and go out of his way to put no blame on Russell Wilson, which I think he deserves plenty of blame for last season, but to put it all somewhere else. Because the one thing we didn't talk about when we the first time around was that he flamed his own general manager.
Right. That's a good point, because I thought about that after the fact. He's still the GM.
Yeah.
Wait, what's his name? Kevin Saunders. It's still the GM.
Right. I mean, so I think Payton probably afterwards was thinking, yeah,
Sean Payton, not Sean, Kevin Saunders.
Right. Yes. Sean Payton, like, I think having to go apologize was the worst part of it, because it's like, then you just look like you bungled the whole thing. You're a fool. Like, and had you just stuck to it, I kind of would have been like, Sean Payton's kind of balling, just doing what he wants to do. But instead, you know, when you have this thing 2 days later, we got to, like, come up with this fake apology. I don't know.
It is fun because I think both of these guys, you know, Rodgers is obviously going to be in Canton one day. Sean Payton's going to have, like, a case for it. So these aren't just, like, mid-level guys taking shots at each other.
I love it.
That's why.
What a story.
Week five.
And you might have missed the summer episode. Maybe people are coming back now. We decided collectively as a group, the Around the NFL podcast, that because Sean Payton's there and George Payton, the general manager, it's too confusing.
Right.
So we just changed George Payton's name to Kevin Saunders on the show.
I think you're helping journalists everywhere, too, because you don't have to do the song and dance where you put their first names when you mention them both in the same article.
And right. I have mixed feelings that you circled back here because you want to reward the people who have been with right. us throughout the offseason.
So you get it, too.
But understand, this is it. It's yeah. Kevin Saunders moving forward. No yes. more catching you up.
And to that point, people that come after me or either of my colleagues here in studio on Twitter or elsewhere saying, whoa, he really butchered that. He doesn't even know the GM's name. You will be flamed for it.
Mm. Right.
With full, keep Kevin Saunders' name out of your mouth.
We actually have a way to prevent you from ever listening to the show again. We can geo-block
your ace.
Your podcast app of choice.
That doesn't really help us. That's a strategy that does of no service to our
players. Danielle Hunter and the Vikings make nice, agreeing on a one-year, $20 million contract. Hunter, Gregg, has been a difference maker for the Vikings. 71 sacks since entering the league in 2015, 3 Pro Bowls. There's a no-tag clause here that gives him a chance to hit the open market and get a more lucrative deal. So, you like to see this team and player working together for the common good. And, geez, the Vikings need all the help they can get on that side of the ball.
I think it was so important. I think Brian Flores, they're really excited. Like, they really could improve so much on defense. But his defense, for instance, in Miami, always has good pass rushers. I love what Kwesi Adofo-Mensah did with this Vikings team this offseason. And I think you can see it by how he handled Za'Darius Smith and Hunter. They both wanted out. I think he did the right thing moving on with Za'Darius Smith. That just wasn't going to work. They knew how important Hunter was. And for once, like, a team just gave a guy a raise. Like, he was due only $5.5 million. They decided to give him a big raise. They're recognizing how important he is. He can be a free agent after the year. And it's, like, great for both sides. I think that was probably their plan from the beginning. He let the player, in this case Hunter, calm down. So good job by Kwesi.
Yeah, they have completely cleaned the books. And so I think this was a give Brian Flores a centerpiece and a chance, because we can get into this a little bit later, but some of the whispers out of Vikings camp is that, you know, Flores is working with a lot of young players, but almost to a man, they seem genuinely excited about the Flores scheme, about the contrast to what they were doing last year, the overcomplexity of last year's defense compared to what Flores is setting them up to do. So Hunter sits in the middle of all that. You still have Harrison Smith, but it's going to be a big transition. You've got a lot of young
players.
What's
the official team slogan of the 2023 Vikings? We talked about it last week.
I don't remember.
Well, it was so effective that I've completely...
Wasn't it like Happy Trails at Donatello?
Yes, it was. Check you later at Donatello. Yeah.
Let's circle back to the Broncos real quick here. Tough, tough news out of camp today where wide receiver Tim Patrick, who once not so long ago, last summer, was seen as maybe their number one wide receiver or a number two type guy with them. He's not going to be involved with the team for a second straight year, it sounds like, because he suffered what is believed to be an Achilles injury, collapsed to the turf during a 7-on-7 drill. He missed all of last season after he tore his right ACL in a non-contact drill on August 2nd, so almost a year to the day. I mentioned my dad suffered an Achilles injury a couple of weeks back, about a month ago. It happened in front of me. It was not fun at all, but I know from learning more about it through my dad and his subsequent doctor visits, when the Achilles goes, it goes, you know. So even though we don't have confirmation right now, if they think it on the field, they could tell right away, and that's terrible news. It's a tough injury for any athlete to come back from.
They were talking about him as, you know, some were saying he was the best football player in the receiver room this offseason. They were really excited to have him back. Obviously, he was always underrated. I can't imagine, because these guys vanish off the radar. We just move on with who's still available. But it's like Tim Patrick has gone through 2 years. He's about to go through 2 years of complete and total hell. Because I think the one thing you hear about, I remember when they featured Gronk on the rehab journey, that you're just spending all this time alone. You're just alone. And, like, if you're Tim Patrick, you know, your dad doesn't have to go run a 4.3, 4.40 a year from now.
I actually did tell him he has to do that.
Well, that would be remarkable.
Key. Yeah.
And he might find a different line of work if he's able to do that. But, I mean, Tim Patrick, you're wondering, like, it could take you 2 years or more to get back to where you are physically.
I'm really glad. He signed, because he was an undrafted guy, he signed a pretty nice extension late in the 2021 season, which is well-timed that he got his money before all this happened. It does make you think if Cortland Sutton was going to be traded, if someone, I just thought Sutton was very much available. We heard Sutton and Judy was available, and it felt like Sutton was more available, that at the end of this camp, if someone needed a receiver somewhere, there was no one more available than Cortland Sutton. Maybe a little less available now. They're still fairly deep at wide receiver. They've got a couple young players, Marvin Mims. They brought in Callaway, but I would think now Sutton is much more likely to stay there.
And finally in the news.
From the two, first and goal.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
For the touchdown. Sony Michel, his sixth touchdown in the postseason. Three against the Chargers, two against the Chiefs, and now the first touchdown of Super Bowl 53.
Super Bowl 53, a two-yard touchdown, the only touchdown in that game, the worst Super Bowl.
The greatest Super Bowl ever!
13-3 Patriots over Rams, the final Tom Brady Super Bowl, and it was, yes, Sony Michel, who had that lone touchdown in the game, the two-time Super Bowl champion. He won another one with the Rams a couple years back. He decided to retire on the opening weekend of training camp with the Rams. He's 28 years old, four-year college career at Georgia, had the run with the Patriots, and Sean McVay called Michel the epitome of a pro.
129 yards in that Chargers game and three touchdowns divisional round.
Did you say six touchdowns in that postseason?
Six touchdowns in the postseason, 113 yards against the Chiefs in that AFC Championship Classic and a couple touchdowns, and a game-winning Super Bowl touchdown. And no one remembers that. It's like Jeremy Shockey had a game-winning Super Bowl touchdown with the Saints. I feel like no one ever remembers that one either. So that was a controversial pick in New England. Everyone wanted Lamar Jackson. That's a great sliding doors moment. Mm. Then again, they got that sixth ring and with Sony Michel. So you
I have a great sports
I don't know
stock.
If they would have done it without him.
I have a great sports stock idea, Gregg. I think you would like this. Maybe it's a little too esoteric, but I kind of like it. That Patriots run of what would it, 02 to 18? Does that kind of encompass it?
Yeah.
01 to 18. Just about the running backs. Just there's so many different guys that just went in and out and all had amazing moments. I would watch 15 minutes on, what's his name? Jonas Gray? I'd do 15 minutes on his Sunday night four touchdown game and then missing his iPhone didn't go off the next morning. And he missed practice and never played again for the team.
What, like LeGarrette Blunt looking like Jim Brown.
Corey Dillon.
Out of nowhere, yeah.
All these dudes.
This is it.
Not bad, right?
You know how our friend Jordan Rodriguez did the playmakers this offseason? That's going to be
That'll be yours.
That's going to be yours next season.
I'll pass this idea off. I don't need to be too hands-on.
You got to get a producer, Greg.
With a Patriots 0-1-18 breakdown. But, Greggy, if you want to take it, I'll just be EP. Yeah.
The Patriots could have drafted Nick Chubb, who was, you know, drafted after Sonny Michel. But
teammates in college.
Yeah.
That's
so passed on Nick Chubb and Lamar Jackson. Maybe we're burying
Lamar. There was a lot of buzz.
Where did you have Bill Belichick in your GM rankings?
Well, there just was a lot of buzz there. It's with Lamar back then. It is. I can't imagine really like being an NFL veteran. And you show up to camp and you're just like, I can't do this. Maybe it's your body. Maybe it's your mind. It happened to Eddie Goldman too, for the Falcons again. This is actually the second time this happened that they thought he was going to be a part of the rotation, and he just was like, I can't do it.
There's always nothing beats the Vontae Davis at halftime being like, yeah, I'm out of here.
Yeah, this is.
I don't feel like doing this anymore.
Good. And you should know, Greg, it's good to all get little bones thrown our way on this podcast. Every time a Patriot retires that was connected to that run, it finds the news rundown and it never gets shot down because we know you like it.
I think in this case, you know, we had
to
recognize Sonny Michel.
See, I even gave you that highlight.
Sneaky, big moment in history.
All right, we'll be right back with some whispers.
Whispers.
Gross. Welcome back.
So gross. We should maybe do some live reads.
Maybe.
Live whispers.
Maybe. And maybe we get some female voices in the whisper. It just seems a little aggressively
us.
Us.
Yeah, it's just a lot of us whispering in your ear, which I think would be unappealing
hey,
to
me. Hey, Mjark. How about some whispers?
Don't need that.
That one's good. Hey, Stapleton, if you want my Taylor Swift ticket, can you give me a little whispers at some point throughout this segment? Just drop it in occasionally. Get that headset on. She hates this. That's why I like it. All right. It looks like she's going to go along with it. All right. Let's get into it. Whispers. What are we hearing? What are we following? Beat reporters are filling out notebooks, writing dispatches from training camp where the pads are now on. Football has started. It's back. Start us out, Greg. We're going to go around the horn a bunch of times here with things that we have culled from our research.
Okay.
Tireless research. Go.
The most meaningful whispers to me are players we didn't know about emerging into roles. And I think that's happening with an undrafted rookie named Deneric Prince in Kansas City.
Son of a...
Because there's always so many right now.
But that was a good one.
They haven't put on the pads and everything, but everyone there that we trust say he's popped so consistently and is playing so often with the starters that he's a little bit about like the Isaiah Pacheco of this year for that team. They certainly have some room at the running back position. And it makes me think of this Chiefs team in general. You think of them as this dynasty, and they're getting back to the same place every year. But because of their setup with it, they really have like a stars and rookie contract kind of roster that there's a lot on the line. Like Rashee Rice, their rookie wide receivers, having a chance to play with the first team. Their linebacker spot where they signed Drew Tranquil is definitely a little up for grabs, and he might take some playing time race. So there's a lot of position battles there, but Deneric Prince is one that I think is going to get drafted in fantasy league. So that's a
fun one. We just did 5 minutes on Sonny Michel, and you took the one I was most excited about.
That's why I took it first. Just felt very whispery.
I think it is whisper. It's
5 on Sonny Michel.
I think it's notable that pads are just going on, and beat writers like Adam, is it Teicher?
Teicher,
and others are saying, well, he's an undrafted rookie, but he's already on this roster. He's made this team. Now it's just about, is he going to be a special teams guy, or is he going to really find a way in that running back room to make an impact? And you're right. I think that's part of what makes the Andy Reid side of things and this Chiefs dynasty in part so interesting, is that it's not just a collection of all-stars. It's Mahomes, this great offensive mind, and Reid, and then Kelsey, obviously, you got to put him in the mix. And then how they find and develop young players as satellites around these Hall of Famers. And we'll see. Maybe Prince won't come up again on this show. That's possible, but it could.
Yeah, because I was reading about him too, and other players are emerging from the woodwork to talk about how impressive he's been. And like the one thing I love about Andy Reid, because it's like, how do you avoid sort of rote exhaustion? You've won the Super Bowl a couple times. You keep coming back to do the same thing. Their training camp, there was a feature on this on The Athletic by Nate Taylor, that practices have been insane, that there have been fights 3 days in a row.
Kelsey, every time.
Kelsey was in fisticuffs with someone named DiCaprio Boodle, so I love that
Who?
DiCaprio Boodle, a defensive back on
Hell
the team.
Hell yeah.
So it's like, you know, a lot of young players, a lot of stars, and heated practices. And Reed is loving it. He's just been saying, he's been shouting, edge, edge, edge. We're never going to sit down. And I think the Chiefs just find a way to reboot.
And I know Kelsey.
Reboodle.
Apologized and said he has to control himself. No, I love that.
Yeah.
A team that's had that much success fighting in training camp, they still got the fire.
Shout out to Pete Sweeney over at Arrowhead Pride. We might have to have him on if we want a Chiefs guest. They have some of the best like recaps of any practice in the entire league. And there's so many battles going on. I'm just seeing here on his timeline here, one of their undrafted rookies that they were playing like as a starter in a lot of snaps, Nazee Johnson, sounds like he's suffered an ACL injury either Sunday or Monday. So that is disappointing. Mm.
Whispers. That's not Christy.
Not at all.
Was that Kelly?
It's the counter opposite.
Sean, it's past noon. Do we have any updates on the Taylor Swift run?
No updates on the Taylor Swift run as of right now. There's been inquiries waiting back. Think it might be an afternoon. I did say 12 is like a middle of the day, so I heard Monday, so I'm like going to start at 12.
Oh. But you said 12 to us. I think an important thing, if you're going to be talking to other journalists, accuracy
yes,
is important.
You.
Oh, yeah. That
don't
was
just,
not,
don't
that
just
was
make
not
up a number.
I just picked the middle of the day.
So you threw out that time, but you just threw the first possible second that becomes afternoon, which is noon?
Yeah. Well, I assume like in the middle of an average work day, right? Average
you do
work day
you do stand-up, right?
Yeah,
so
I
like
do.
When you're doing a show, you don't just like say a time specifically and then it could be any time.
Right. No, come to the stage in the middle of the day.
Yeah,
Come see me in the middle of the day up in you know.
I never like exactly said 12 was the it was going to be on the nose.
This entire episode has been built around the drawing happening 5 minutes ago.
Oh, no, yeah, no. If that is what you thought, I apologize for my inaccuracy. This is why you're the journalist. And
no,
I press
we love
buttons.
You, Sean. We should, you've destroyed us. Marc, you're up.
Love you all.
I love the reports about emerging players, which we just did. I also think there's guys that we spent all offseason wondering, like, this guy still got it? Is this going to work? And so I go to Giants camp where Dan Duggan of The Athletic talked about the fact that Darren Waller, who I was like, he might be washed. Maybe this was a nice idea, nice trade, but like he has been uncoverable all over the place, frying their defensive backs to the point where like rookie Deontay Banks, who they have a, you know, they invested a lot in, is having a very uncomfortable, rough start to camp, largely because of Waller, but other reasons too. But I think that's a huge, huge element for the Giants and Brian Daboll. If you get this version that the Raiders basically gave away, it doesn't look good for the Raiders to give this player away after, you know, injuries, everything he went through. But if you get the best version of him, it's great for Daniel Jones. It's great for Saquon Barkley. It's great for an offense that kind of quietly has like 22 wide receivers too right now. They kind of remind me of the Bills where they just have done everything they can when they had Josh Allen to reload and add guys. And Waller working out would be huge for the Giants.
It would be huge. There's a little, to me, a little trope alert element to this that new player with Pro Bowl
Trope
pedigree
alert.
Shows up
Trope
and,
alert.
You know, moves around Trope well and the beat writers are all kind of smitten by it.
Right, but there's a trope alert sort of attached to every one of these things, I
right.
think, to some degree.
But that, I guess, just with Waller.
Marc didn't appreciate that.
It's
not personal.
It's not your reporting. It's notable to me.
But he's...
He hasn't been healthy in a while, so I did find that notable.
Yeah. Like,
he has not
he's
been
healthy.
Looking good on in practice
right.
for a long
you know
time.
You know what triggers me?
What?
Waller. Is moving all over the field. Like,
I
it's a, whatever.
I
of course
that.
He's going to be
but
moving.
But this was the exercise.
He's going to line up here. Maybe he'll be in motion on this play. That doesn't do anything for me. He's moving all over the place.
Well, we've said that the season doesn't even start till the Super Bowl.
He's
so
a movable
none of this may have any meaning.
Yeah, I am a little – I have some doubts about the Waller-Giants thing, but maybe that's informing some of my criticism here of the reporting. I don't know.
Get him to week one. I think he is one of the most important people on that roster. If he could pop, that's huge.
And other whispers. The 49ers quarterback's going ham. The Niners offense, this was a report from Nick Wagoner, ESPN, had its best day of camp. This is over the weekend. Trey Lance, 12 of 16 in first-team reps, 5 of 8 with a touchdown pass and a touchdown run in red zone work. Sam Darnold, who took the other 4 first-team reps and 12 with the second unit, 8 of 10 with a pair of touchdown passes to Brandon Ayuk in the red zone. We talked about last week that Brock Purdy has been cleared and seems to be on target for week one. I guess my takeaway based on this is, yes, usually you hear, especially this time, camp defenses are ahead of offense. I kind of think I have no concerns about the Niners because I think the team is kind of quarterback proof, which is such a obviously highest compliment you could give to Kyle Shanahan for what he's good at. I think they're going to move the ball and score points really no matter who's quarterback. I think Darnold would do well in this offense. Trey Lance is such a mystery, but I would think that Shanahan would put him in the best position. And we saw that Purdy has the ability to move this team and be proficient as well. Niners going to be good.
I want to add to your report in the newsroom this morning.
Not my report.
Well, your entry.
Reporting on the report.
Your yes. Yes, your review of the report. Omar Ruiz in the newsroom today. And
love that
guy. I asked, you know, like where you've been to a couple camps. He's been to Raiders, Arizona, where it's like 114 degrees. You're wearing makeup and it's running into your hair. It's a terrible situation.
Tough
but went up to San Francisco and I was like, did anything like stand out about any player you saw at any camp? And like, I know this is a player that we've talked about before is like, this is the year he becomes a superstar, but there are like superstar vibes around Brandon Ayuk that like what he's been doing up there. And he mentioned Sam Darnold, like whipped this like 15-yard bullet.
Sam Darnold!
Right into the end zone. And like this player emerged out of nowhere, high into the sky, and it hit him right in like the hands. And it was like Brandon Ayuk jumping like twice his height almost. So everything is going right for him. And I'm with you that the Niners just feel like they're picking up where they left off on offense.
I think it was on Roto-World, I think, had a passing reference to Sam Darnold as the next Steve Young.
That's what Shanahan said. Right. Couldn't he be the next Steve Young? And that quote to me was like the end of Trey Lance's career in San Francisco.
Yeah.
I was just like, I guess it's obvious because even just the way they're cutting up the reps, Purdy is healthy enough that he's taken off one of every 3 days, but otherwise he's getting twice as many reps as those two guys combined. So it's really Purdy's team. But the fact that Darnold, who just joined the team on like a 1 year, $3 million contract, is splitting reps with the guy who was the unquestioned starter who they gave up 3 first round draft picks just a year ago at this time and who was getting all the reps. The fact that Darnold is splitting with him already, like they're not even giving Lance a chance. I do wonder if Lance is on this team even in week one.
Oh, I think they want to trade him. If anything, feature him in the preseason and ship him out.
Give us another one, Greg.
Okay. Let's go negative. It's hard to be negative first
week. You don't usually do that.
Week. No, I got a lot. Jets. I actually am concerned about their tackle situation, their offensive line. Mark, Dan's taking this off. What am I, taking it from you?
You took my second pick, too.
Actually, I should have. I could bury this one. You want?
No, it's too late. You started.
Yeah, that would be anti.
Okay, Mekhi Becton, that's not looking good.
That
so
was mine.
Yep. Hasn't really been healthy.
Not good at all.
Dwayne Brown. Turning 39 this year, I think, and was like okay last year. Still hurt, still on the pup list. So I don't know what's going
shoulder.
On. Shoulder. They drafted Tippmann, second round center, but the idea was like, okay, that's like maybe 3 of those 5 spots. For now, he's second or third team. Who knows? That's not a huge concern. It takes rookies some time to get lifted. But if Billy Turner and who is it, Max Mitchell are your tackles, and they're struggling every day in practice against some good players, that's the huge fly in the ointment. It's more than a fly. It's a cockroach.
Yeah, it's we talked about it, Greg, when we talked about what are the training camp early storylines to keep an eye on.
Yeah.
I mentioned the O-line, and this is so far for everything that's going great around the Jets, and it's basically everything else. This is the one unit of the team that leaves them very vulnerable. Becton sounds like he's a mess, I got to say. They had
I thought he was like
he lost a ton of weight.
Positive offseason.
But he hasn't played in essentially 2 years, and they finally kind of start working him back in to training camp, and they have to shut him down on Wednesday. Salah said that his rehab knee wasn't up for it, and this comes when you've heard, you know, whispers, things I've heard from people that know I like the Jets will tell me about his, you know, his dedication and how, you know, his love of football is it there, and it's yes, he dropped the weight, but when he learned that he's basically in a competition to be the right tackle, and he's tweeting a couple, like a month ago, that he's a left tackle. Like, is his head even in this? Is he about football, or is he?
And they're not playing him with the starters, even when he is.
No, so I think everything around Becton, both physically and mentally, is a huge question mark. The second round center, it sounds like, yeah, like you said, he's a little behind. And yeah, you do want to see Dwayne Brown get out there. Now, are they being extra careful with Brown coming off surgery in his late 30s? sure, but you also want to have reps as a unit together when, yes, you are protecting a quarterback who's nearly 40 years old himself. Hamana, it's the only thing. I think if this offensive line is good, everything else, barring a lot of injuries or whatever, the Jets will be a great team. But the line has the ability to really cause havoc. And Dalvin Cook, by the way, it seems like it's going to happen, but we don't have it officially yet.
Man, he was on Good Morning Football, and like he really sounded like there was a connection there.
He was like there on Sunday just watching practice.
Yeah.
It would be weird at this point if he doesn't sign there.
It would be really weird. Yeah, he was like signing autographs, and there's like 3,000 fans chanting his name. All right, Mark, you're up.
Buffalo.
Whisper.
I like this because.
Who's that? Oh, it's Eric. That's good, Eric. That was a good one.
It's good.
That was live?
That was live, yeah.
Oh, dang.
I'm emptying out the whole bench. I'm going to have everybody do one.
Christy has disappeared, so I think she sees it coming down the pipe. So she's like,
she doesn't like to do on-mic stuff.
Conveniently not in the room as the show's going on.
She doesn't like that stuff.
No.
So she took off.
There's a humility to her.
I see Randy in the back, though.
Yeah, Randy did whisper one in last run around, but you got upset over Greg taking it and you threw your headset off. So
I missed Randy's? Okay. I apologize.
We'll get Randy.
Greg, I apologize to you, too, for that. Actor belligerence on my part.
He thought you were mad at him because you took it off as he whispered it, so his eyes got all big. Like
Randy, it wasn't about you, bud. It was Greg's fault that I got mad. All right.
I should have known. Don't take the Jets topic. How many years have we been doing this?
I don't know how many years. Many, though.
Wait, but if you in your next turn get his third topic,
that would be good.
Can I tell you something?
Incredible hat trick.
There's literally no way.
Okay.
He can get my next one.
Okay.
Because I know Greggy, and there's no way he'll have the take that I have.
Okay.
You're up.
Dalton Kincaid, Buffalo. I mean, there are positive reports bubbling up about, in general, this rookie tight end class. There's a couple people dotted around the league. But I like this because Kincaid, I think, like, they didn't go get DeAndre Hopkins. People questioned why they didn't draft like a wide receiver high. Kincaid's going to be used that way. And like if he was a bust or he's not picking it up, you got problems, I think, on that offense. But instead, they talked about Joe Piscaglia from The Athletic, does a great job with the Bills, has said that he's just looked the part. Like he's just had this like incredible feel. He's been getting nonstop 11-on-11 first team work. Josh Allen is already like in sync with him. Hitting him all over the field, blah, blah, blah. I know you don't like all over the field, but he is looking
he looks
like
the part of an NFL tight end.
He's like a week one NFL starter. And I think in general, tight ends, you got to wait till year two or three to see who they are. And maybe if that's not the case here, Buffalo arrow up in a very tough AFC.
Yeah, I think we've talked about it, the tight ends in recent years haven't set the league on fire, which makes it even more. And wide receivers have. A lot of these wide receivers come into the league and they're immediate difference makers, and the Bills, we know, need somebody to come in this year in a key year for the organization and be a difference maker on that offense. I hope Kincaid is, because I'm rooting for the Bills.
He's so much fun to watch. Rookie tight ends tend to struggle a little more with the mental side of thing and then the blocking too, so that's going to ramp up when you put on pads when you start tackling. But yeah, you were referring to, I think, Sam Laporta.
Yes.
Especially, he's been getting juice. That was my guy in the draft. I fully expect Laporta, who's getting a ton of hype, and Kincaid, who is getting it as well, are going to be week one starters. Whether they come through or not, like, we'll have to find out, but I don't think it's going to be them being brought along slowly. I'm excited about Laporta.
They're talking about Laporta as like literally flat out looking at one of the best players on the field. So and this could be like we haven't had a tight end class like this in a long, long time. That would be.
I do like that. That is a trope too, but I do like that one. Best player on the field one. That means that it's to the point where
it's excessive.
He's just cooking everyone and he just looks better than everyone. Usually that does translate. There was a lot of that, I have to say, as a Jets fan, with Elijah Moore as well. Like, he was like one of the all-stars of the best player.
Yeah, but who's
field.
Getting hype right now?
Elijah Moore.
Moore all yes. over the place.
So that's the thing. These guys,
month.
He is lining up all over the place.
This is
as
his
well.
Month.
This really is. Like, the guys who make people miss, you know, who run the best routes, and a player like Kincaid would fall in this too, in terms of a tight end versus linebacker. Like, they're going to win these one-on-ones before the, like, it's a great month for like 5'9", 170 pound slot receivers. But now we've seen in the NFL, you know, that
and like the beat reporters who are 75 yards away from the action and they got the binoculars on, like, oh, he made that guy miss. Who is he? He's winning.
Yeah, but then there's like the first round cornerback that looks confused and lost.
Right.
On the variance of reporting, I'd rather like,
and to be clear, 5'9", 170, when I say that, it's not in a derogatory way. That man is huge compared to me.
Right.
I'm saying, like, that's a monster, 5'9", 170.
Speaking of the Bills, Cam, DeMar Hamlin back in pad.
Depends what your body shape. You could be 5'9", 170. It could be, like 88% body
I think
fat,
they're all
right, gelatinous.
I think
right.
That's true. That's a good point.
DeMar Hamlin's back in pads. How about that? Is that crazy or what?
It really is. And
he was resuscitated on the field in December.
It's crazy,
pretty
wild.
Because I was going through the our lads and everything, and man, they are deep at safety. He's their fourth safety. I think there's no way you're going to cut DeMar Hamlin, and he was a good player for them, special teams and as a fill-in starter. But they're really deep there. Like, he's going to be no higher than fourth on the depth chart if everyone's healthy.
You're up, Gregg. Actually, try to get it. Try to bang me in a big spot here.
Okay. I'm whistling a tune here out in Arizona. A Clayton tune. Here's my my whisper. There's like a non-zero chance that Clayton Tune is a week one NFL starter as a rookie.
Yikes.
If you're not familiar with Clayton Tune's work, and I wasn't either, I believe he was at Houston, right? He was at the University of Houston, air raid guy.
Inflated QB numbers typically.
But yeah, popping him out. Very old for a rookie. He's like 24.
He's 24.
Fifth round pick. Take a little higher than some people thought. Some people liked him. Some people didn't.
Sam Howell territory.
His name, for some reason, you just imagine that he's like this try-hard little guy. But no, he's actually like prototypical size.
6'3", 220.
Size, and he moves pretty well. He's taking a lot of the first-team reps, but everyone is there. I find this fascinating that this is what's happening at an NFL team. They say Colt McCoy is not taking any more reps than anyone else, that all four quarterbacks there, which is not a good sign. Jeff Driscoll, Colt McCoy, David Blau, and Clayton Tune are all taking reps. And McCoy's maybe like late in the mix, and maybe they're bringing him back slowly off. But Tune seems like the guy that they're gearing up. And that I think I'd be surprised if Clayton Tune doesn't start multiple games this year. It might be later in the season. And I feel like there's actually a chance you might turn on a week one game and Clayton Tune will be the starter just because either
it's not going to be a primetime game.
It's
but,
probably going to be Colt McCoy, but like at some point it's probably Clayton Tune, which is just crazy. Maybe he'll be good.
It's crazy, but I could see like four different quarterbacks starting for them this season. And like,
but like, why start Jeff Driscoll and David Blau? This group drafted Tune, so I think
David Blau is not a terrible option if you're trying to win three games. I'm not saying that.
But I don't think they're trying to win, but they are trying to develop.
I think they're trying to win three games, to your point.
I think
not anymore.
Right.
You roll a rookie out, a low around rookie out, because it's like the plan is clear.
If they can develop Clayton Tune into a good backup for Kyler Murray or whoever is the quarterback next.
Sure.
That's a victory. But if you play Colt McCoy, what is Colt McCoy doing? He's a placeholder for a team that's obviously going nowhere this year. It makes more sense that you would start younger guys.
I think so.
Even Blau.
Because like, I think Cole McCoy, I mean, they had a lot of issues, but like Cole McCoy might put you in the world where like if you get the good version of Cole McCoy, you suddenly were winning a few too many games maybe.
Right, and they didn't even, it's not the same GM and coaching staff. I'm sure they love Colt McCoy, but you got to be a little worried that every time he goes out there, I'd just rather see him as a backup, the guy who's like the coach.
Remember, I saw Colt McCoy in the Super Bowl hotel lobby.
You thought he had a nice bod.
I thought he looked to be vibrant.
Vibrant thing.
Everyone acts like he's 72 years old. Like he looked better than like anyone else in the lobby of the hotel.
Who, Colt?
Yeah. It's like, oh, by the way, here's an NFL quarterback who's like in his early 30s. Like he's gonna look better than 96% of the other men trouncing around with their Starbucks and their croissants and like whatever else they're
doing. And he's in his late 30s. He's almost 40.
But he looks younger than that too. He's sort of ageless.
I mean, he's in tremendous physical condition.
Professional athlete.
Yeah.
He's a quarterback. Quarterbacks many times are attractive people.
Yeah.
And they're just different than us. Even Colt, who doesn't seem like an athletic freak, is
that's how he came across in person.
All right, everybody, hold up 1 second. Let's take a break and then share some more whispers. All right, we're back. Gregg, I know it might seem that I'm more critical of Lamar Jackson and the pro Ravens agenda that you sometimes push on our platform. I know it seems that way.
Yeah.
But I think some of it.
Just your denial of it is the annoying part.
I think some of it is just a frustration from my standpoint that Lamar sometimes, it seems like he ducks, not him himself, but the way he is portrayed in the media narrative around the Ravens as not really being at fault when things go wrong for an organization that has, by the way, one playoff victory in the last 8 years. Okay. And Lamar's been there, what, five of them now. My point is, I think Lamar, just like the Ravens front office and the roster, needs to improve as well if they're going to really get to their true goal, which is winning the Super Bowl. And with that said, a minor but interesting note out of Ravens camp where new offensive coordinator Todd Monken has eliminated Jackson's use of a wristband to call plays in the huddle. Since he's been the quarterback, it's been common that he uses the wristband to call in plays. And Monken came out and explained that that is part of what we're trying to get rid of, because the offense has been pretty rigid in the previous under previous leadership. He didn't call out the previous coordinator, Gregg Roman, but
that's how you treat a
right. The
coach.
Play calls getting in late. Here's what Monken had to say about this this change in terms of the setup for play.
One of the most important things is if your ability to communicate the calls, and the best way for that to happen is to not start with wristbands. He has to hear what I say. He has to process the call. He has to regurgitate to the players. He has to get the cadence. We can always go to wristbands. Wristbands are easy. You just read it. Hard is learning the offense, being able to process and make the calls.
So that's interesting to me. It's actually empowering Jackson. If you can handle this, Lamar, and you're able to do this side of it just in a different way, that will give you more power to change the plays at the line of scrimmage, will get plays into you faster, and the offense can perhaps improve because even before he got hurt last year, the offense wasn't operating at a high level. Monken and Lamar, with a better surrounding talent, there's going to be pressure on them, obviously, to be much better. A small but somewhat interesting nugget out of Ravens.
I like that. I think he's showing faith in him. It's not a slam on Lamar. I mean, you're in your sixth season. I think, you know, I've always thought, like, doing the work of being a quarterback physically versus the suddenly having to call like a 27-word play, I would probably be baffled on how to do the latter, not if not the former also. But like,
I think the former would be tough.
I'm just saying they're different. They seem like different skill sets. But
Thinks he's Patrick Mahomes back
no,
there. I'm just gonna freestyle.
I've never understood like how they do that. But like this assumption though. Because my last memory of Todd Monken in the NFL was he was on that disastrous 2019 Browns staff as a sort of quasi-offensive aid-slash-passing-game type deal. And it was an absolute mess. And Todd Monken's done a lot in his career, so I hope it goes great for
them. It
was
kind of a mess with the Bucks, wasn't it, too?
Well, right. There's this assumption.
He went back to college and had a lot of success in college, and he had a great reputation at the beginning of his Bucks time.
Right. But all that could materialize. Like, I mean, you know, he's there for a reason, but it's like this thing about Lamar Jackson, is he going to throw 6,000 yards and all this? Like, a lot needs to happen for any of that to work. I thought it was more than that, but like...
I was thinking of the Chicago.
Yeah, no, I think he put out a preposterous number. It's like, okay, but there's
awesome.
A big wait and see like aspect to Todd Monken / Lamar Jackson. Like, the only thing is if Lamar struggles with the wristband situation, it's a new offense to begin with. Like, we saw what happened even with Shanahan and Matt Ryan that first year. It was like, you got a lesser version of Matt Ryan before he turned into an MVP. Like, there's a lot of variables here, and I don't know. It's this assumption that they're going to be explosive just because they have Odell Beckham. Yeah, okay, maybe.
I think the key is the getting the plays in and having flexibility to change it. It's great. You just can't be running an offense in 2022 where you're basically not audibling, and if you're not starting like an early rookie quarterback. And it is a little crazy that, and I think that's why Gregg Roman got a lot of criticism. Nothing wrong with a wristband there. I mean, Tom Brady wore a wristband pretty much his whole career. He liked it.
I think they're just trying to streamline
it. But
things.
I get it.
Yeah.
But you know, I went and looked at Lamar's Pro Football Reference page, and you say like the unnecessary like lifting up is like without delivering. I'm not a QB wins guy, but the man was.
But now I'm going to use it to strengthen my argument.
I'm just saying, when he started over the last 5 years, he finished his last season only 25. 45 wins, 16 losses. That's just
nice.
So you got to pay attention to that kind of team. And oh, by
he's
the way,
he's been a great
greatest
regular season player,
running quarterback.
Oh, ever. By the way, he did say, he said, I think I told someone, like, man, I want to throw for like 6,000 yards with the weapons we have. Okay.
Awesome. I mean, I think TBD. He's just throwing out 6,000.
I know. I'm not saying, you know, just got on my radar. It's like there's the confidence is there. I hope it works.
Developing news.
Wow. Oh, Tom Brokaw.
Developing news on the Taylor Swift tickets. Just want to say, per source, I have inside sources. The names have been pulled. Some final approvals are being waited on right now.
Ooh,
so,
that's a little shiesty. Final approvals?
Yes. So
whether the names that were pulled,
you can
or
say no to someone that won a raffle?
This is what I'm very confused by. Obviously, there was multiple. There per email, with 8 tickets were available, so I'm assuming 2 tickets per person. It would be 4.
Four sets.
So the names have been pulled. So, and approvals are in the works per source.
What is
approval? Hold on, but see if, like, the reporter
unlike
thing that we're talking about.
Email content, yes, or something?
When we talk about the reporter aspect of what you're doing, which that's a nice, this is good information.
Very good.
Follow-up question. Like,
yes.
Because that's, that suddenly
approval
makes no
for
sense.
What? Right. Would be the.
All I know is I heard approvals, nothing more, nothing less than that. So
well,
I
yeah,
don't know what that means.
Can you dig on that? Can you see what are they what are they seeking in terms of approval?
I will put in some work with my sources.
Maybe it was like some hotshot third floor executive one, and they were like, oh, this is gonna look bad.
Yeah, yeah,
as much as I don't want that to happen, because God knows the people on the third floor, they could spring for the secondary market. I gotta say, if they're in the raffle,
they win,
and their name comes
they
out
win.
I'm not gonna complain about
they
that
shouldn't yeah. the raffle then
if you want to take fair. Them out, that's fair too, but once you allow them in, we can't have an approval process deciding who's worthy of the ticket.
That's basic raffle integrity. And I don't like this. We're behind the scenes toying with the results. That sounds fishy.
All right, keep digging, Sean. We're going to come back to you at the end of the episode.
We'll, if I have any updates, we'll let you know.
I once won the Rams raffle very early on in this
that
building's
huge,
history.
Yeah.
And then I think the rule was you could not enter another raffle for a certain amount of time. So I don't know if my
that seems sketchy, Greg.
I think it was
I remember you won
year.
That. That seemed very
like
something
week.
Very suspicious.
Great.
All right, let's go around again one more time. Greg.
Just one more time.
Well, you could throw out a
well, because one is a silly one, and I just want it's more of a point that I want to make. The Packers sent out a happy birthday message to a young man. I don't need to put him on blast even.
Shove it.
On Saturday, send out a happy birthday message. 2 hours later, they released him. And so what we need to do here is we need to get social in the meetings, I think. If they're having, you know, Matt LaFleur and the GM and everything's there, like, we now need to bring in the social media element into that meeting so that they can avoid a mistake like this in the future. Because you got to work as one organization. You're responsible for that.
Yeah, that you're absolutely right. Better,
not a whisper, but more
that
was a take. I just
want to point that one out. The Seahawks running back position feels cursed.
Oh my God.
Kenneth Walker, were you taking this
one? You got
one
me. You got the hat trick on the Zeuser.
Yeah, all right, you take that one then, because I got another one I like a lot. Asante Samuel might not start in Los Angeles with the Chargers, I think is very interesting. I don't know why it took them a couple of years to realize this, but like, they need people that can tackle. They're such a bad run defense. He doesn't really work in the slot. They're going to have Jasir Taylor there, who is a safety. Now J.C. Jackson's back. But you also had Michael Davis played really well last year. It's interesting because Asante Samuel's made some plays, but it really sounds like he might be the guy on the outside looking in this year. That's a little whisper.
I like that. You got one more?
Oh, well, one little nugget.
No, I was going to say, Greg, did you have one more to get off your chest before we – or you got a natural connection point
I would
that,
say
Ron?
That, like,
go ahead.
We're wondering what Kellen Moore's offense will look like, how they'll use players. Like, Mike Williams, who has been a natural dominant outside receiver, has been playing in the slot a lot.
Move it all over the field.
Oh, everywhere.
I do have one. I do
put
have
him
one
on the outside.
I do have one
inside,
more.
You put him in motion. The guy's
do your
athlete.
One more. Do your one more. One more means one more, not eight more.
People were excited about that, about Cowboys drafting a tight end.
No,
Luke Schoonmaker, thinking like, oh, they kind of reach for this guy and put him right in the lineup. And it does not. It sounds like he might have a lost entire camp, and it's going to maybe be Jake Ferguson as their starting week one tight end. So a little disappointment there. A pretty vaunted second-round pick they were hoping to get something out of, and might be out for at least a few weeks.
Tough sitch. Mark?
Justin Fields revealed that he's a pescatarian. Do you know what that is?
Yeah. He does only eats fish or doesn't eat fish?
He eats fish, but he doesn't eat, like,
meat.
steak, chicken, but yeah, any other type of
just fish
feet, like food that comes from animals, basically.
Right.
Or maybe cheese.
But he was vegan, so he's adding the
fish
to the mix.
I think that's, you know, there's not
so
that many.
Slowly, just what is going on with your meat journey, by the way? You had the double cheeseburger.
I don't know if I call it a meat journey. That's not attractive, but
it's not inaccurate though.
Yeah.
I mean, it sounds like a great Saturday night, a meat journey. Put me on it. I'd like to take a meat journey around the South Bay.
I did try the for
Where
the
are
first
you at
time.
With meat?
I don't. I'm not. It's just like a small part of my diet. But I did try, like, because I used to go to In-N-Out and I'd get like the grilled cheese with kind of thing. You know, with nothing.
Yeah, they would get the In-N-Out truck used to come to our old office sometimes, and everybody would get, you know, the typical burger. Mark would get the grilled cheese, which was always like.
So I tried their actual burger. Yeah. And I've been hearing for like a decade plus, it's one of the greatest thing that's ever happened to Los Angeles or the planet. Like, totally overrated.
Oh.
Well, for instance, remember the one I had with you?
This is a tired take.
I also think every take about In-N-Out is tired. But I just
In-N-Out's like, moving all over the field.
I just ate it and like it was like, okay, that's fine.
You know what it is?
Fine.
It's that part of California culture.
I think the more that you eat it,
yeah,
and then it's the children. And the more you eat it, everything is good. It's the regularity that it's available everywhere. So that's just replacing McDonald's, essentially, but at a much higher level. Without the kids being in the mix, then, yeah, I see your point.
Yeah, well, I'm not trying to make a big point. I just thought it was
How many times are you eating meat a week?
No, not that much. Like twice, maybe.
Oh, that's
like
a lot.
I'm more just trying it like little spots, you know, like had steak one time, which was amazing.
You did.
At Musso and Frank's, like just.
You went to Musso and Frank's.
Oh, I go there often, but like it's, I never.
Schwaz.
Huh?
Schwaz.
it was incredible. Was incredible.
But there's a certain cocktail you got to get at Frank and
Musso. I've gotten it more than once, yeah. We should do it. We should go sometime. Next time you're up there.
I would love to.
Okay.
Whiskey sour at Frank and Musso's.
Anytime.
Just like Rick Dalton.
Mm-hmm. You can sit in those same seats.
Love it. Place is old fashioned, old school. Seattle Seahawks, they are cursed at running back, Greggy. Ken Walker. Because every year we talk about how amazing that running back room is going to be, and then they draft and they load up, and it's like, wow, you know, they're just going to keep coming at you in waves. And then, like clockwork, injuries creep their way into the room, and they're not wasting any time. These guys are just getting pads on. Ken Walker is sidelined from Seahawks practice with a groin injury. Pete Carroll made it sound like this could be an injury that could cost him significant time. So we'll see how long he's on the shelf. And then you have Zach Charbonnet. He's out indefinitely with a shoulder injury. And he was, you know, so this went from, Greg, this like Charbonnet versus Walker, and are these guys going to be, who's going to be the true alpha here? Now, we might not have either of them on the field week one. We don't know yet, but it's just not a great way to start.
I just feel like every season this happens. And there are some teams in some positions that are like this, but especially starting like with the Chris Carson era. But they've just like every year there's injuries. And I think they're, you know, guys who are taking the first team reps right now are DJ Dallas and
Kenny McIntosh. That's a real person.
I was going to call him Rocky McIntosh. I don't know. This sounds like that would be a name. But this always happens. It's very disappointing. And as someone whose son owns a Kenneth Walker shirt, you know, I'm always rooting for this guy.
What are any millennials behind the glass that remember the movie about the
Shad
kid?
Penny was always hurt for them. Everyone
always hurt. The movie about the kid who found the $1 million. Maybe that was before their time. I think his last name was McIntosh.
What happened
that
in this
blank
film?
Blank check. Yeah, he found a blank, or he got hit by a car backing up, and the guy says he's in a hurry, gives him a blank check, runs off, and he like makes a fake persona with a computer, like back old school computers, and like something Macintosh. And he uses like the AI voice. Yeah. Yeah.
Sounds absurd.
Has some like old FBI chick hit on him.
Somehow never heard of this movie. We were 15 years old, so we were a little old for it when it came out.
Yeah. He was Mr. McIntosh, he went by. No, it was a very weird Duff, who was an MTV VJ at the time, was breaking into acting. She plays like an older woman in her late 20s who's like in a romantic relationship. That's surprising how many movies in the 90s have a child, usually a boy, that has some type of crush on an older woman, and then they have some type of romantic moment
like,
at some point.
They run through like some museum sprinklers together. They have like a night out on the town. And
bizarre.
Well, remember, what about Big with Tom Hanks turning into a child and having all sorts of adult adventures?
Just you don't see it anymore.
No, I think it's a bit off the
grid. We don't need to.
I was expecting it in Oppenheimer, a little bit of it.
Don't need it.
Yeah, I thought Oppenheimer would be a ripe territory.
Third act?
Yeah, I think you're right.
A little Duff and McIntosh running through the fountains?
Yeah.
Anything else? So, oh, can I just say, can we pull up the Rams T-shirts? You know, this is a trope itself. Head coaches, as long as I remember going to Jets camp in 99 after they went to the AFC title game, and Parcells said, everybody's going to wear this T-shirt. It's going to say start over on the back because last year didn't happen. And then Vinny blew his Achilles in week one, and they never did start over. So Sean McVay has a T-shirt that they're bandying around at Rams camp that says the following on the back. It's a mouthful. Is that Sean McVay wearing it?
That looks like one of our slogans.
That looks like Stafford.
All right, this is all capital letters across the back. Mentally and physically tough players who play smart and love to compete. Mark, as you and I entered this company as primarily as copy editors, the thing that really jumps out to me immediately is the top line and is spelled out. And then the second to last line, between smart and love, there's an ampersand.
That's driving me nuts.
Why the inconsistency there?
I don't like players two words away from play.
And's pretty close too, even if it was both spelled out.
I would have maybe workshopped this a little bit. It's a mouthful. If you ask the players to take the shirt off and repeat the slogan, I'm sure.
Is it a bit? Or was this really?
No, this, I think the players might have made it, so McVay might have been off the hook. It was actually Cooper Kupper, Matthew Stafford's.
But who's responsible for the and
I don't
the
know.
Ambersons.
Well, I think it's more who's not acting responsibly.
Jordan Rodriguez, if you do hear this episode and you could maybe fill in a little bit on this to give us an idea of why the Rams T-shirts are the way that they are, that would be helpful.
Well, plus it's like when you're a player, like what's going to get you excited for that day's actions? Like, hey, like guys, let's go be mentally and physically tough players who play smart and love to compete. Like no one's ever spoken that way in the history of the human race. Oh, what are you like at work today? I'm just a mentally and physically tough player who plays smart and love to go. Yeah, the two plays is terrible.
Unsolicited advice, something that would be maybe a little more just you could picture on the shirt. Compete.
Well, that I think that would ring through the.
Isn't
team
that just kind of
yeah? Just it you could remember.
If you want to stylize it, put a period.
Well, there's no
hell.
Period.
Put an exclamation point. There's put a slammer on the. I don't care, but let's shorten it up.
Yeah, there's.
You want to get really crazy? Do the Spanish like backwards slammer and the slammer.
All right, I like that.
And it's like,
are we
getting tacos with this? Like, what has happened?
You never know. You never know. All right. Anything else? I think we're good, right?
We're great.
Anything else from Sean Keller, developing nerves? Last thing, Taylor Swift raffle.
Don't play it. There's no developing news.
Okay.
I haven't heard anything. I'm not told any more information, and I just have to. We have
you
to
didn't
wait.
Even did you try?
Yeah, I
did. You follow up on the approval.
The
approval.
I was told the approvals. I was not allowed any more information on the approvals. That was it.
But there are approval. There's approval protocol. You can confirm that.
There's approval protocol.
The story's pretty big, actually.
I mean, so. I don't sense that he did a ton of work.
He didn't.
After
he didn't push back at
talk,
that point. That was
I can't know, push I, a lot.
He's showing
I,
his
I did
rookie
as much as I could.
That's not how a journalist thinks.
To be a true journo, you have to be dogged, bro.
You don't go tell. I did as much as I.
You
know,
don't
felt
accept
like doing
easy answers.
You can't if you risk rubbing people, and you're such an agreeable guy, and you're such a nice guy, Sean. I know you maybe don't want to rub people the wrong way, but sometimes you got to unturn stones that people don't want you to unturn.
You could find out where this person's office is, and just go up. Sometimes you can get something.
Kick the door in
when there's not a when there's not a digital footprint. Sometimes people are a little more willing to give you the truth, you know, not on email.
Person to person, I'll take that advice. Thanks, guys. More information will come when available.
Check out Sean Kelly on social media. He's a stand-up on the rise, by the way. Go see him in the LA area.
That's true.
All right. Good stuff. Good stuff. We'll be back on Wednesday with more coverage of the National Football League as football is back on Thursday. But it's the start of football being back. You guys get it. Until then, Dan Hanzus signing off for Quiet Storm, the old boss, Eric Roberts, and the gang behind the glass. Approvals. Dirty.
Murky.
Heed the call.